In this video, I'll show you how to configure notification rules for the 2016 R2 release and later. Keep in mind that starting now, the notification rules are based off of event frames, and the event frames have to be set up first. So if you haven't seen event frames yet, if you're not familiar with them, make sure to check out our videos on event frames. In this example, I'll go ahead and set up notification email alerts for when a piece of equipment at our plant goes down. So the first thing I'll want to do is open up PySystem Explorer, just like how I have here. And I'll need to be using PySystem Explorer 2016 R2 and later. So I've got that. And keep in mind, the specific actions that I'm going to be doing require write permissions in this AF server. And if you have questions about what are the security permissions needed, make sure to check out our documentation. So let's take a look at this AF structure. I have different sites, and basically at each site, there's different production lines. And for a given production line, there are several pieces of equipment that are part of that line. So let's take a look at some of these equipment pieces. I want to know when the equipment goes down. And as you can see here, there's actually a status attribute that we have, and this indicates if the equipment is running. So I can see that this particular piece of equipment is running now, and that's great. On the other hand, let's look at something else that isn't necessarily running. Okay, like this one. For example, this piece of equipment is going through a downtime, and this is exactly the type of situation that we want to create alerts for. And we can even see that there's a fault code that we're tracking to know the reason for the downtime. So this is information that we have built into our AF structure. And I mentioned as a prerequisite, we have to have event frames set up for this. So why do we have to have event frames? Well, starting now, the notifications history is stored in event frame annotations, which is why we need them first. Previously, notifications history was stored in PI points, but moving forward, it's all about the event frames. So let's confirm that I've got event frames already set up. I'm going to switch to library, and all the pieces of equipment that we were looking at before are built using our equipment template. And if I look at the specific analysis template, you can see that I have an event frame generation analysis already set up for monitoring my equipment downtime. Keep in mind that you don't have to use event frames that are created with the event frame generation analysis. You could also use event frames that are created with the PI event frame generator, or manually, or even with custom AF SDK applications. The key thing is to make sure that you have event frames set up. And I also want to point out for this particular event frame generation analysis, what my trigger condition is. So if you look at start trigger here, you can see that the start of an event frame is when the status does not equal running. And I've only got one start trigger specified. Since I already have this set up, the next thing is to go ahead and actually start configuring my notification. If you've worked with notifications before, you might be used to looking for a notifications tab down here, which was the case for previous versions. Now, the path is to go to the notification rules templates and to use this to create notifications. So we can create notification rules from our equipment template if we want to set up the notifications on a template basis. If we wanted to create a notification for just an individual element, we could go ahead and do that. Let me point out that back under elements, there's actually the notification rules. So you would do it on an individual basis here, but I want to set this up for all of my equipment elements, so I'm going to go ahead and use the template approach back here. So if your event frames are not set up using the event frame generation analysis like I have, you'll just want to go ahead and navigate to the notification rule templates if you're working on a template basis, or the notification rules on an element basis. If you have event frame generation analysis like I do, we're going to actually use this button to create a new notification rule template, which will pre-populate some of the notifications trigger for us. Okay, so you can see that now we've moved over to the notification rule templates. If you clicked on this directly, then you can have the option to create a new notification rule template. And if you're doing it that way, you'll probably see that there's a big red exclamation mark next to the trigger and that none of the information has been filled out. You'll want to go ahead and configure the trigger. In our case, because we have the event frame generation analysis, some of the information is already pre-populated. But we'll take a look at this by going to View and Edit Trigger. Now, for the trigger, the key is that whatever logic is generating the event frames will serve as the trigger for the notification. And that's broken down right here with this sentence. The notification is going to get triggered when an event frame is created that matches the criteria. And in our case, it's for the selected analysis because we have the event frame generation analysis. So this filled in, we've got the equipment template, which we're on, and the equipment downtime, that was the specific analysis that we selected. And here the trigger relationship is again a one-to-one. If an event frame gets created, then a notification will be also generated. If you aren't using the event frame generation analysis, you're going to change your criteria mode off of analysis to the event frame search. And here, you're going to specify the criteria for what are the event frames. So again, it's still the equipment reference element template, but maybe we can say, let's go ahead and trigger the notification when an event frame is created that uses, say, a specific template, like in this case, our downtime template. So in addition to doing the search by template, you could also use name or category here. One thing that you might see and have some questions about is this attribute value down here at the bottom. I'm actually, again, remember on the analysis, so I also see that same option here. What is this for? As I mentioned, right now there's a one-to-one relationship between if an event frame is getting created to also trigger a notification. But you can actually instead trigger for only a subset of your event frames based on specific attributes of the event frames. Let's take a look at how we could do this. For this example, let's say I'm part of the maintenance team and I don't want to receive a notification for any equipment downtime, just the ones that are specifically due to unplanned maintenance, because those are the ones that I'm directly responsible for handling. I can go ahead and set the notification up to use this as the trigger. So I'll change the attribute value. I'll use that fault code that we saw earlier. And I'll go ahead and do the trigger for when the fault code equals unplanned maintenance. Okay. So now only the event frames that have downtimes due to unplanned maintenance will result in the notification being triggered. Additionally, down here at the bottom, there are some other options. And check out the documentation for some specific details. But just to quickly highlight some of them, while I'm going to be sticking with the defaults, the resend interval is for if the notification should be resent after a certain time, if the event frame hasn't closed or been acknowledged. And the non-repetition interval would be for not sending similar alerts within a set time frame. You can see here there's also the option for the event frame can be acknowledged. And if the event frame is acknowledged, that would stop notification escalations and resends. And we actually have a video where we show acknowledging event frames. And this last option section here is specifically for event frame generation analysis that uses multiple start triggers. Remember earlier, I only have one start trigger, so this would not impact mine either. Okay, so I'm keeping these at the defaults, and I'll go ahead and hit OK. And now I have my trigger completely specified. And one thing that I want to do is I want to go ahead and actually fill in a name and a meaningful description for this notification, so that way it'll make it easy for us to keep track of it. So this case, this notification is for equipment downtime due to unplanned maintenance, so I'll call it unplanned maintenance equipment downtime. And I'll go ahead and give it a description, and I'll go ahead and assign it a category too. The next part of the configuration is for subscriptions. We'll need to specify who should receive the notifications and what format should the notifications be. In our case, let's stick first with view and edit subscriptions. So this is where we can drag contacts and add them as subscribers to the notification rule. In my case, I can see that I am listed here, and I can go ahead and select to send the notification to my email, just like that. And once you have a particular subscriber listed, you could do to notify at the event start as well as the end, which I'm interested in, so I'll go ahead and select that. And I could drag more subscribers in, and I could also leverage escalation teams, groups, other delivery endpoints. In my case, I'm just going to stick with adding my personal email here, but if you want to see more about how to leverage these other options, check out our other video. You'll also see that the configuration has what format will be used, and right now it's the global default email. So I'll go ahead and hit OK. And if I want to look at that format, I can go to Manage Formats. And here we see the global default email, and I can see what is going to be contained in the notification for that specific email format. Now, in another video, I'll show you how you can actually go ahead and duplicate the format and make changes to it, or create a new specific delivery format. For now, I'm just going to stick with this global default and hit OK. So at this point, I have everything configured for my notification. So I'll go ahead and check this in. And now if I look under an individual element, I can see that we have a notification rule set up for that element. And if I wanted to look at starting or stopping all of the notifications at one time, I could actually do this under the Management tab here. So the Management tab, and then focusing on the notification rules, I now have options to do things in bulk, like stopping or starting these notification rules. So right now they're all started, and this is the state that I want them to be in. So I'll go ahead and leave that as is. And actually, I'm getting some email notifications. So let me show you the notifications that I'm receiving based on these rules that we just set up. So here's an example of a notification that I just received. It looks like we're having unplanned maintenance for this specific piece of equipment. So Seattle line 1 L344. Let's go ahead and confirm this. So I'm going to switch back. I look at Seattle line 1 and look at the attributes of this equipment, I can see indeed it's a good thing I received this notification because we have a downtime due to unplanned maintenance. So now I can go ahead and respond right away.